to be with you in the house of the Lord. It's time to worship him. Can I hear an amen? Hallelujah. Lord, we love you. We praise you. We thank you. Come and have your way in your holy name. Church, as we step into this next portion of worship, I just want to encourage you to just adjust your posture however you feel led. If you want to sit, you can sit. If you want to stand and lift your hands, you can stand and lift your hands. If you feel led to come to the altar this morning, the altars are open. But Heavenly Father, this morning, we are here for you. We need you. We want you. We invite you to come and do what only you can do, Jesus. We approach your throne humbly. We know, Lord, that you oppose the proud. And you give help to those who are humble. And so, Father, this morning we approach your throne humbly. And we lay everything down at your feet. We ask for you to come and help us, speak to us, lead us. let your presence rest on us this morning. In your holy name.
Found in your hands fullness of joy. Every fear suddenly wiped away. Here in your presence, all of my gains now fade away. Every crown no longer on display. Right here in your presence, heaven is trembling in awe of your wonder. The kings and their kingdoms are standing amazed here in here in your presence.
Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Declare the name of Jesus this morning.
Jesus in the darkness,
there's power in the name of Jesus.
Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name. Jesus.
Hallelujah. Come
shout
on, let's
Jesus
declare it one more time. Given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess. Let's give him praise in this place today. We lift up the name of Jesus, the name that is higher, the name that is greater. You are our healer, you are our provider, you are our everything, and we look to you today, Jesus. You are the answer. We look to you today, Jesus. It's all about you. We welcome you into this place. All over this place with your eyes closed. If you feel comfortable just lifting your hands, just welcome him into this place. Be enthroned on our praises today, Jesus. We don't want to just be good at hosting people. We want to be good at hosting your presence. So we welcome your presence here, Jesus, to work in our lives, to dwell in this place. We welcome you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Amen. Let's give him praise this morning. Thank you, Jesus. As you're seated, why don't you turn to a couple people and tell them welcome to the Lord's house today. Great to see you, and we have some very, very special guests that are with us today. They are heroes. They are people we love. They are people part of our church family and that we're connected to in a deep way. They are missionaries, and I'd like to invite Jared and Amanda to come forward if you would welcome them. They hold a special place in my heart, especially because I went to college with Jared way back in the 90s, back when it was a while ago, and they felt the call of God in their life, and you were with us a couple years ago, and it was a great time. And so tell everybody where you've gone. How long ago were you with us?
Yeah, so good morning. We were here, would have been like August, early September 2021.
Okay, so you've been gone a couple years.
Yes.
2 years. Okay, where did you go?
We went and we've been living in Africa, in the city of Malabo, which is the capital of the nation of Equatorial Guinea.
Okay, so where is Equatorial Guinea?
Right.
For those of us that don't know Africa.
Because everybody knows where that is. No, it's a very, very small country. The best way I can tell you to find it is if you're looking at a map of Africa and you find Cameroon, right below Cameroon is a really, really small country. And then as a part of that really small country, there's some islands, and we live on the biggest island, actually.
Okay. All right. So not only Africa, the other side of the world, but then a small island off of Africa. How far is that island from the coast? You said 12 hours on a boat?
Right. So if you take one of the boats, there are no passenger ferries. There's cargo ships that come from the mainland.
Okay.
That takes at least 12 hours.
All right.
And you have to just buy a ticket and sit somewhere on the ship. There's no
with the chickens and the cows and the pigs.
Whatever
and
else is there.
All right.
Usually we fly. It's about a 40-minute flight.
Okay, so tell everybody, why do you fly?
Because in the 2 years that we were there, tragically, they've lost two ships.
Okay, so I would fly too. Amen.
Yeah. So we fly.
All right. So you're on this island. You left. You were living in the Bay Area. You were youth pastors. You felt God call you, right?
Yes.
And you went to Africa, to this little island off the coast of Africa. Left everything. This is why we call them heroes. Amen. Left everything. How many kids do you have?
We have three kids. Okay. Our daughter Abigail's 16, and then our boys are 11 and 7.
Okay. You went there, and in the Assemblies of God, what they do is they itinerate. We call it itineration for a year, raise support. And then they go to the mission field the first time, 2 to 3 years, and they come back, and then 4-year term. So 4 years there, 1 year back. So you're headed now fully appointed missionaries, which is a big deal. They were missionary associates when they left last time. Now they're fully appointed Assemblies of God missionaries. So let's give the Lord praise for that. Amen. So you guys will go back for 4 years, right? So
There's some things that are in transition of how they used to do it, how they now do it.
Okay.
We know for sure we'll be gone for 3. We're trying to be with a possible extension.
Okay.
So now they tell us to plan for 3 years. Hoping for 4. We'll
all right. Extend. So what are you going to do when you go there? What did you do, and what will you be doing? What's your mission? What's your goal in Africa?
So this first trip, we really were kind of laying groundwork and building relationship. There were no missionaries in this country when we got there. A work had been started and had been tended faithfully, but that missionary retired. So we kind of were starting things back up. We preached, we taught in seminars, we raised tabernacles, which is it's basically a pattern church. It's steel that we put up, and we put roof on top of it, and then we challenged the churches to build the walls to close it in. So we put up 4 or 5 of those for churches. We put one up for a Bible school dorm.
By the way, Assemblies of God builds these tabernacles all over the world. You go over the world, we call them tabernacles, very simple buildings, cheap to build, and we host churches and other things there.
Yeah, they're a great gift from the church in America to the church around the world. A couple of them we built actually are going to be block-making factories. Our national leadership thought it would be a really cost-effective move for us to build our own cinder blocks. That's what they build for all the tabernacles.
Okay.
So now we have a block-making factory on the island and a block-making factory on the mainland.
All right. So you're in the block business now as a missionary.
That's right, yeah.
That's great.
So it's good.
Great. So, Amanda, what has been your biggest obstacle? Or tell us this. Yeah, what's been your biggest obstacle? Tell us that. As a family going on into Africa and living for...
I think the biggest obstacle was just getting everybody and like, okay, we're going to make this commitment. We're going to go. You know, our kids are not little kids, and our oldest was a freshman in high school, and convincing her that it was going to be okay when I didn't know it was going to be okay. She was volunteering in her youth group. She was, you know, getting ready to go to high school, and just really trusting God. with our family. It is far away, and he did some really big things for us there. So we're very, very thankful.
Awesome. So tell us, what is the big, we're talking about miracles, we're month of miracles. Tell us a couple of the biggest miracles that you've seen, things that were notable to you in your last several years.
So one of the greatest things for us was actually something that River City was a part of. This church was the church that put us over our goal so that we could get cleared to actually leave the United States and go to Africa.
Yeah.
That was back in the fall of 2021 when COVID was still kind of opening countries, closing countries, all that stuff.
By the way, this was a super cool moment. They were at 95, 96%, and they came and they were trying to get, you cannot leave your country till you hit 100%. And they were trying to get there. They came and spoke at River City. They came to our board meeting. God just moved on the hearts of the board, and we stretched and we gave them enough, plus some, because we know some people actually don't give. They'll say they'll give, and then they don't. Plus some, and you were able to leave to Africa right after that because you guys generously give. Come on, let's give the Lord praise. We're able to do that for them. So tell us.
So because of the timing of all of that, our country had been closed, and then this window opened up where the borders were open. We were able to buy some plane tickets, get to our country, and then literally 8 days after we arrived, they shut the borders again. And so it was this miracle where we were able to get in this tiny window of space. We had teammates that wanted to join us and couldn't, but we were able to arrive. We were able to lay the groundwork for the team that was going to come, and it was just a total God moment. We built relationships with the local pastors. They showed us where to buy groceries, all the stuff you need to actually survive. But it was just, it was miraculous, the timing of God, because he so orchestrated our steps from a closed country to open for just a short time where we could get there, and
then closed again
right into another set of COVID restrictions.
Wow. Well, praise the Lord for that. I'm glad we got to play a small part in that. It was a cool moment for us as a church. Do you have one you'd like to share too? And while they do that, Jeremiah Rose, will you come on up? I'm going to have you pray over them in just a moment, okay?
I have two real quick ones about our family again. Our daughter who went and, you know, I wasn't quite sure. She wound up getting baptized while we were in Africa.
Wow, that's cool.
Of her own doing. And so it was a really big deal. And the other thing is that we live in a country that still has issues with malaria. And our family was protected the entire 2 years. 5 years, 5 months before coming home, the medication that we have to prevent malaria was no longer available. And so we just continue to pray and ask the Lord for protection and health over our family. And we're so thankful that we never once got touched with malaria. And
oh,
so,
praise the Lord for that. Blessing. Praise the Lord. God is good. Amen. Amen. I'm going to invite you, if you would, if you'll stand for a moment, just so that we join in unity. Jeremiah Rose, the Vice President of the Board, will you pray over these guys?
I'm so happy for them. I'm excited for you guys. Aren't you all so proud of them?
Amen.
It's people like this that we need more and more. Yeah. The Lord told us that the harvest is plentiful.
Amen.
But the laborers are
few.
So, God, we just thank you for this couple, Father. Thank you for the answer of yes in their hearts to the call of God. Father, we just pray that as they go again, Lord, that you would just give them a new, fresh anointing.
Yes, God.
God, we pray that you would just begin to show up in more dreams and visions and ideas. And Father, we pray for just fruit, Lord, of the work they're doing. How scary to step out and with the kids and all the things they've done, Lord. And we just pray that you would just prepare the way. We know that a righteous man's steps are ordered by the Lord.
Amen.
And Father, we pray that you would just bless them, bless their family. God, we pray just new anointings on their words as they go. And Father, we pray that you would just increase with them. As they would increase with you, they would increase with men, Father. And we just pray that it would just be a new sweet time.
Yes, God.
Of fruit. We pray for a big harvest in Jesus' name. All God's people said,
amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Let's give them a hand one more time. We'll be taking a dollar. You can be seated. We'll be taking a dollar offering for them in this box right here on the way out. And it's what we do for our missionaries to send them off with a good offering. And if you have your Bibles today, you can turn with me to John chapter 6, and if you have the little life book, which we are going through, this is the book of John. You can turn to page 33. If you'd like one of these, they're going to come down the aisle right now with some more of them. We're in these for 4 weeks. This is our third week in them. We'll be in them one more, and we want you to have them because you can write all over them, kind of tear it apart, and spend the first month of the year in the book of John. Mark it up, interact with it. This is our month of miracles, so we're talking about miracles. Then every Sunday, what I'm going to be talking about is laying the foundation for some prayer, and then we are going to be persisting for miracles, and that is going to be happening this Wednesday at 7. So something the Lord laid on my heart the end of last year, where we're calling them prayer rooms, and what it is, it's a time that you can come and get prayed for. So it's not your typical prayer meeting where you come at 7 and you pray for an hour. There's going to be a team of people here that are ready to pray for you Wednesday night from 7 to 8. So if you need a miracle in your life, your family, whatever it may be, there's nothing outside of the bounds of what we're going to pray for. You come anytime between 7 and 8. You might stay 5 minutes. You might stay 10, whatever it takes to pray for you. And we'll spend some time just persisting with you in prayer and getting in the face of God with your need. And we really want to push in to the presence of God with that. So that will be in the Life Center this Wednesday night at 7. So this last Monday, our family went to Top Golf. And I don't know if you've ever been to Top Golf, but we went to Top Golf and took all of our kids. And our daughter Elsie, she's 15. She was horrible. She was the worst golfer ever. So she took the golf club and she's like trying to hit the ball, right? Trying to just hit it, and she's getting it off here and there and knocking it off the tee. And she doesn't know how to hold it. And I'm just sitting back laughing at her, letting her do it. And she's swinging all over the place. The whole place is looking at her as she's trying to figure out the golf club. And finally, my wife said, "You got to stop laughing at her. You got to help her. Go help her. Come on." So I'm like, "Well, that's not as much fun, but I'll go help her," right? So I went up. I'm not a great golfer, but I've golfed some in my life. So I said, "Okay, Elsie, you got to, this is what you do. Get in front of the ball. The ball is here. You can't stand like this. You can't do this. You got to stand just right with the ball. And then you got to line it up. Line the ball up with your front foot. You got to position yourself just right. Get just the right distance from it. And then you got to take your fingers and intertwine them. And you got to take the head of the golf club and put it right on the ball. And you got to visualize it. Look at the ball. Don't take your eyes off. Go back and give yourself a nice swing. Was that a good swing or what? Come on. All right, for you golfers. All right, I should take the anointing oil and hit it through. No, I'm just kidding. So you gotta do this, right? You gotta position yourself, get in just the right position. There's like 10 things you gotta remember to hit the ball right, just right with that head, just the right swing, straight back, look, give it. You gotta position yourself, get every single thing right. Now listen, I want you to hear me today. If you are gonna see miracles in your life, you have to position yourself for the miracle. Okay, the way you position yourself is very important for what you see happen in your life. And up here on the screen, if you'll hit that next slide for me, it says this. It says, if you're going to see a miracle, you must position yourself for the miracle. You got to get the right position. Listen to what it says next. If you're going to position yourself for the miracle, it begins by you believing your God is big enough to accomplish that miracle. Now listen, this is the one thing. I told you there's all these things that Elsie had to know. Boom, boom, right? And she beat me after actually one of the games, all right? So you got all of it right. There's only one thing you've got to get right if you're going to see a miracle in your life. And it's this. You've got to believe, well, we like to put a lot of formulas to it. Only one thing. Okay, listen, you've got to believe that God is big enough to do what you're asking him to do. Do you know what it's called? It starts with an F. Faith. You've got to have faith. You've got to believe. It's the one thing that you're required to do to position yourself correctly to see a miracle in your life. A.W. Tozer says this, "What comes to your mind when you think about God is the most important thing about you." Why? Because it positions you. It's the very basic. You will not move beyond. Forget all the formulas. Forget all the things. Oh, you got to walk in this way. You got to stand this way. You got to pray this way. You got to have a certain like healer come and pray for you. That guy over in that place, he comes, or you go to him. Forget all of that. You simply need to come in faith, believing and knowing who God is. It's the very basic. It's what positions you. How you think about God is the most important thing about you. Listen, if you believe that God is absent, you're agnostic, you believe he exists, but he's absent from your life, listen, you're going to be believing for Nothing. If you believe that your God is small and you put your God in a box, you know what you're gonna believe for? Small things. But if you believe your God is incredible, if you believe your God is great, if you believe your God is bigger than anything you're faced, do you know what you're gonna believe for in your life? You're gonna believe for big things. You're gonna believe him to do incredible things. You're gonna believe that he can do what you need him to do. See, what we need to do is we need to take our eyes off the size of our problem and put our eyes on the size of our God. Come on, let's give him praise right now. We need to take the eyes off the size of the things that are happening around us. You've got to believe. So take the book, turn to page 33, okay? Page 33. And the title of this miracle is Jesus Feeds the 5,000. I want you to scratch that out. That's not inspired. That's just what they wrote in the book here. That's not inspired. What I want you to write there is a mind-blowing miracle. Because that's exactly what this is as you begin to dig into it. It is a mind-blowing miracle. And as we look at this today, your mind is going to be blown by how incredibly huge your God is. And as your mind is blown, this is why I want to do this today, as your mind is blown by how incredibly huge your God is, do you know what you're doing? You're positioning yourself for what God needs to do in your life. So we're going to read this miracle in its complete, then we'll go back and we'll pull a few things from it, okay? So a mind-blowing miracle. After this, Jesus went to the other side of the Sea of Galilee, which is the Sea of Tiberias, and a large crowd was following him because they saw the signs that he was doing for the sick. And Jesus went up on the mountain, and there he sat with his disciples. Now the Passover, the feast of the Jews, was at hand. Lifting up his eyes then and seeing that a large crowd was coming towards him, Jesus said to Philip, "Where are we to buy food so that these people may eat?" He said this to test him, for he himself already knew what he would do. Philip answered him, 200 denarii would not be enough food, buy enough bread for each one to just get a little. One of the disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, "There is a boy here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 fish, but what are they for so many?" And Jesus said to them, "Have the people sit down." Now there was much grass in that place, so the men sat down, about 5,000 in number. Jesus then took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed them to those who were seated, so also the fish as much as they wanted. And what they had when they had eaten to their full, he told the disciples, "Gather up the leftover fragments, that nothing may be lost." So they gathered them up and filled 12 baskets with fragments of the 5 barley loaves left by those who had eaten. This is an incredible miracle that Jesus does. So I want us to start by setting the scene. If you'll notice, all of these miracles that we've read in the book of John, they start with a few words that reflect back. This one, it starts with these two words, after this. After this. After what? Well, the book of John has 7 miracles in it, and each miracle is greater than the last miracle. Each miracle builds upon the miracle that Jesus had just done. They get more dramatic and they get more intense. I mean, watch their progression here. Water into wine. He changes the molecular structure of the water to make it wine. Then he heals an official son from a distance, and his fever breaks at the same time that Jesus says that he will be healed. A great miracle, not dramatic, in several different places. There was not a crowd that was blown away from it at that moment. Then he heals an invalid who instantly gets up and instantly walks. And now what does he do? He multiplies food. You might ask, well, how in the world is multiplying food greater than his past miracles? Well, at first he changed something. Then he fixed something, and now Jesus creates something. He creates something from nothing. In Genesis chapter 1, it says, "In the beginning, God," what? "Created." In the beginning, he created the heavens and earth. That word "created" in the Hebrew is bara, and it means to make something from nothing. Jesus made something from nothing when he performed this miracle. Look at John chapter 1. We get the thesis. If you've got your books, you can turn back to page 17. We get a thesis of the book of John. It says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God," speaking of Jesus, "and he was in the beginning with God, and all things were made through him, and without him nothing was made that was made." Do you know that word Greek in the Greek, the word "made" in the Greek? Do you know what it is? To make something from nothing. Jesus makes something. God makes something from nothing. I want you to hear me today. God is not limited to fixing broken things in your life. He can create something new. He can create something out of nothing. As a matter of fact, I want you to hear me today. It's going to go up on your screen. God is in the business of shattering your preconceived ideas of how he must work. He is innovative. He is creative. Do not limit God. God is bigger than what you can imagine. See, where you see a dead end, he sees endless possibilities for your life and for your situation. And when you look back in your life and you said, wow, he's done something great, I want you to hear me, friends, there is more to come. He can do greater. He can do greater. Always keep your hope alive. He is an innovator. He's a creator. All right, this is what I want us to do. Now we're going to go to our text, all right? By the way, thank you for the clapping, okay, right there. All right, because that was good stuff. But we're going to get something even greater here. So this miracle is all about blowing minds, okay? It's all about, and that's what I want to happen to you today. I want, as we dig into this miracle for a few moments, I want it to kind of blow your mind. So this is what I want to do. I want us to look at the characters in the story. We're going to see how their minds were blowing. So you can take a pen, and what I want you to do, if you've got your little book, I want you to circle. There's six characters that are present in the story. Circle all six of them. We're gonna learn some cool things about facing impossibilities and growing in your picture of who God is. And when you do that, it's gonna position yourself for the miracle that you come here needing today. The first character I want us to look at is the crowd. It's not one character, but it's 5,000 plus characters. See, it says here in the book of John that it was 5,000 men. 5,000 men, they only counted men in numbers, but really you could estimate it about 20,000 people if you took the women and you took the children. Just for perspective, in the region of Galilee at this time, there was only 40, which is where they were, there was only 40,000 people that lived there. So this was a huge, huge crowd. 20,000 people estimated. Now, Jesus had been really busy. He'd been busy doing ministry and healing people, and crowds were starting to gather around him, and he needed a break. So he went across the Sea of Galilee to retreat. He crossed the lake. Crossing the lake is about 4 miles, and now he's alone on the hill with his disciples, and the crowds follow him. How did the crowds get there? Well, surely there wasn't enough boats for 20,000 people. They walked around the side of the lake, which was about a 9-mile walk. So all this crowd of people have been witnessing, and they start walking around the lake to find Jesus. Some of them may have even gathered during the walk because it was Passover time. And during Passover, everyone within 15 miles was walking to Jerusalem. So this crowd of people was walking away from Jerusalem and crossing the traffic. So all these people that were heading to Passover are wondering, what are this crowd of people doing walking away from Passover? And I'm sure that they got some of these people that stuck to the crowd to go see Jesus. See, I would call these people rubberneckers. You know what a rubbernecker is, right? We all fall into this category once in a while. Jesus, I call them rubberneckers because Jesus says it in more spiritual terms. He says, they're just after my signs and wonders. They're just there to see. They want to witness what I am doing. I don't know if anyone here has ever watched Penn and Teller. It's a show. It's not a very popular show. It's on one of the off channels. And it's Penn and Teller, who are magicians in Vegas. And they have somebody that will do a magic trick in front of them. And then they have to tear it apart and tell them how they did it. And if they trick them, then they get like $10,000. This is kind of what is happening at this time. You have magicians all over the place. They called themselves mini messiahs or messiahs that they thought they were messiahs. And they would go and they would do trickery. And what they would do is they would plant somebody in a community in a little town for several months, maybe, that was faking like they were lame or faking like they were blind. They would get a reputation. Then they would go in and they would get a crowd of people, and they'd pull that person they had planted, and they will heal them. They'll jump up from their lameness, or they'll all of a sudden see. And so then the people would be like, is this real? Is it not real? They're trying to figure it out. They're rubber neckers, and they're rubbernecking Jesus. They're following Jesus, saying, he's doing some crazy stuff. We've got to go figure out how he is doing it. So there's this huge crowd of spectators that are about to become recipients. Come on, somebody. They're there just to see, but they're about to experience Jesus. They're about to experience a miracle for themselves. It's a huge, huge crowd. In that crowd was represented many, many needs, but Jesus finds the one common need. How far had they walked? 9 miles. took them a few days. So Jesus looks at the crowd and he says, the crowd is hungry. They're hungry. We're gonna feed the crowd. Now, this sounds nice, but can you imagine if you as a disciple are just given the task of feeding a crowd of 20,000 people? This is a logistical nightmare to feed 20,000 people in the middle of nowhere in Galilee. If you were to take that 20,000 people and break them into tables, caterers can do the statistics, it would take 6 acres of tables just to sit them all down. Then the waiting staff. And then where in the world are you going to get the food? And can you imagine waiting in a line for catering with 20,000 people? This is a nightmare. Think of how many porta potties it would take. Right? How many? How many? She did the math. She used to be a caterer. How many? 1,300 porta potties it would take for this crowd. This is a logistical nightmare. How in the world would you feed 20,000 people? Hear me today. God sees your moments of greatest impossibility as his moments of greatest opportunity. And he sees, oh, wow, I can figure out what will be impossible. Maybe that's what I will do. It's going to blow everybody's mind. The next characters in the stories, the disciples. Imagine this experience for these 12 guys. They start the story lounging in the grass on a hill, enjoying a Galilean spring day, learning from the rabbi Jesus. They see a crowd in the distance, and I'm sure their reaction wasn't, yes, the crowd. It was, oh man, here's the crowd. I picture the feeling they got, like the feeling you get when you're at the end of your day and it's like 8 o'clock. For me, it's 8 o'clock, and I'm just done. And I'm done. I tell my kids, I'm done. And I go to my room and I turn on the TV. And then my kids start coming to my room to tell me what's going on or to tell me that they're hungry. It's the same type of feeling. They're like, come on. It's been a long day. We just want to sit here. We want to relax. And here they come again telling us they are hungry. And Jesus, he says, hey, listen, we're not going to, I'm sure they wanted to run. They wanted to hide. We're not going to run. Okay, guys, we're going to feed the 20,000 people. And the disciples, they took on a new role at that moment, from loungers to workers, from students to waiters. And they're asked to do something that doesn't make a lot of sense, because they only had a small amount of food for a large crowd. Now, this is what you could really get from this miracle if you read between the lines. Jesus did not multiply the food and then ask them to distribute it. He multiplied the food as they distributed it. Now, follow me. Listen, the greatest are the least are the greatest. These disciples are now called to be servants. Friends, the greatest thing you can do is serve. The higher you get in the kingdom of God, the more of a servant, come on, get that into your heart, the more of a servant you must be. And they said, Jesus says, hey, start distributing this to the crowds, pulling out of the baskets. I can see their first trip. It makes sense. Okay, all right, I'll do it, Jesus. Then they go back and like, there's not going to be more in there. And then there's more. Then their third trip and their fourth trip and their fifth trip, their minds must have been blown. God sees this moment of impossibility as a moment of great opportunity. And now these disciples, when they step out to what God calls them to do, they become the vehicle for God to do that impossible thing. This is what I've learned in my own life. Every time I step out, God steps up. Every time I step out, it might not make sense. I might not see the answer. But when I step out to do what he calls me to do, God always steps up. And he always meets me there. If that's your testimony, can I hear an amen today? The next character is Philip. Jesus addresses Philip, the poor guy. He asks him the question, where can we get food for all these people? He doesn't ask him, can we get food? Do you think we could feed them? What do you think is going to happen here? He says, assume we're going to feed them. So where can we get the food, Philip? Why would he ask Philip? Because Philip was from this area. So he absolutely and naturally would know the food scene around here. He'd know where the nearest Chipotle and the nearest Panda Express is, right? He knew the food scene. So he's asked, hey, Philip, you're from around here. Where do you think we could get food to feed all of these people? Well, Philip does what I would probably do, and he pulls out his calculator. Okay, there's 12 disciples here. There's 12 of us. We each probably have about 10 denarii each on us. A denarii is a day's wages. So he calculates maybe they all have 10 on them, but Matthew, he's a tax collector, so he probably has 80 on him. Like he's always got money, right? And so he says, okay, so we probably have 20, he tells Jesus, we probably have 200 denarii. And then he starts calculating the cost of food. I mean, inflation was a killer under the administration of King Herod. Like, inflation was out of control. I mean, you take your camel to the trough, and it was double what it was a year ago. They probably have those little signs with Herod on it. I did that on the pumps, right? Like, inflation. That's a good one. That was a good one. All right. Okay, so inflation. I crack myself up sometimes. Inflation. Inflation is out of control. They've done the math. And so Philip, he puts all of this together, and he gives this faith-filled answer. We could take everything we have, Jesus, and we couldn't even give everybody a scrap. We couldn't give them a crumb. Do you know what Philip does in this moment? He applies human reasoning to a God-sized problem. Well, don't we do that all the time in our lives? A God-sized problem, and now I'm gonna take some human reasoning. You would think that he would have thought different at this point. I mean, Philip had saw different miracles, and he'd seen Jesus do 3 already. So when Jesus asked this, you think you would have said, wow, that can't happen, but how cool will it be? I don't see how that's going to happen, but man, this is going to be good, because if Jesus says it, it's going to, you said, I believe, he would start singing that song, right? You think that's what would have happened in his life. When facing the impossible, Philip, though, he takes the God factor out of the equation. He takes the God factor out of his thinking, but God wants to blow his mind in this moment. Friends, when facing the impossible in your life, don't omit the God factor. You are believers, aren't you? You do believe the word of God to be true, don't you? Don't omit the God. We do it all the time. Something happens and we take out our calculators and we try to figure it out in our own reasoning, when in the middle of it, God's saying, just look to me. There's a God factor in the middle of this. The next character is Andrew. Andrew hears the conversation, and I love what he does. He runs and he gets a boy. The boy's got 5 pieces of bread, and he's got 2 fish, and he brings the boy to Jesus, and he makes this statement. What is this among so many? I always try to, like, because you read the words, but what was his inflection? Like, what is his voice in this moment? It could be 2 different statements here. It could be that he's trying to defend Philip and show that it really was impossible. And so it's a negative statement. And he brings this boy and says, see, Jesus, like, what is this among so many? That could be one way, or it could be that he was curious to see what Jesus would do. So he runs and gets the boy and brings the boy to Jesus. And with excitement goes, hey, what can you do, Jesus, with just a few fish and just a few pieces of bread? I can see it's not enough for everybody, but what will Jesus do? And Jesus says, have the people sit down. Get the tables out. Pull out the porta potties. Come on, we're catering this event. Come on. See, listen, when you bring what you have and you place it in the hands of Jesus, it sets the stage for the impossible. And for whatever reason that Philip went to Jesus with this boy, he set the stage when he brought what he found and what he had, and he placed it in the hands of Jesus. He set the stage for Jesus to blow everybody's minds. And then there's the next to last character, the little boy. I always thought, even from when I was a little kid, I would think when I read this story, where are this kid's parents? Like, he's out hanging out with some Galilean fishermen. I bet they're not even fingerprinted. Come on. So the boy's out hanging out with these Galilean drifters, and he brings his lunch to Jesus, and he says, this is all I have, Jesus. But guess what, Jesus? You can have it. You can have everything that I have. This was a big deal because this was a very poor little boy. How do you know he's a poor little boy? Because the word used for the 5 loaves of bread is the word for barley, which is a very poor person's bread, small pieces of very, very dry bread. And then he has 2 fish. That word in the Greek for the fish is opsarian, and it means a sardine. So he has 5 pieces of dried up bread, and he has 2 sardines, and it's all he has, but he brings it, come on, and he places it in the hands of Jesus. And what does Jesus do? Jesus blesses it, And some God math takes place. And he feeds 5,000 plus, and there's 12 baskets left. You might need to get your calculator out on your phone to do this equation. 5 + 2 = 7. That's how our math works. But when you apply God's math, it's 5 + 2 = 5,000, remainder 12. Friends, God's math works out different than our math. And when you place your impossibility in the hands of Jesus, you place it in the hands of the great multiplier. And he can take what you bring him and he can do something incredible with it. When we are doing this build out, I did the calculations myself and I did some work and I worked with some architects and I came up with a number to do what you see in this room right here and the kids center of just over $300,000. So we had we had in our minds $300,000+, and that's, I knew we could do that as a congregation. I knew where we could get the money. And I went and I told the congregation, this is what we're doing. We signed the lease on the whole thing. We're committed to do it. And then we brought a construction company in, and they gave us a bid of over $700,000 for this. I about freaked out at that moment. I didn't know what we were going to do, and I felt like a loser because I told everybody, like, we're going to do this thing. And now we signed the lease, and now we're not going to be able to do it. Well, I went to a minister's retreat. When I was there, this pastor's wife came up to me. She goes, I don't know you, and I don't know what's going on in your life. But God gave me a picture for you, and it's an airplane that is flying, and you're the pilot, and you don't know how you're gonna land this thing, but God wants you to know that you're really his co-pilot, and he knows exactly how he's gonna land the airplane. Wow, okay, I'll receive that one. So I came back here, and I was sitting over in the kids' center on the couch by myself, and I was praying. I had the bid in my hands. I'm asking God, what am I going to do? I don't know what I'm going to do here. I don't know how I'm going to do this. So I just placed this in your hands. At that moment, I have a second cousin whose dad had just died. Now, my dad needed to go see him because he was his uncle. So I went and I got my dad and I took him to see this guy in the hospital. And this guy was there who's a second cousin that I don't know. And he's got a hat on and it's got construction 37 on it. And I thought, I was sitting there and God gave me this picture of the moment in that hospital room with his hat that said Construction 37. So I looked up online and he was the owner of Construction 37. So I called him and told me my problem and he came in and walked it and said, I'll do it for $300,000. Friends, listen, when I decided I can't do it, I've got to hand it to God. Do you know what happened? God came through. And when you take what you have in your hands and you place it in the hands of God, he is the great multiplier, amen? And he'll do what needs to happen. He is the creator. He creates something out of nothing in your life. The last character is Jesus. Jesus had done some really cool physical miracles, water to wine. Worship team, you can come on up. The official's son, the invalid, now the 5,000. If you read the next story, he walks on water across the Sea of Galilee. Get back to the Jerusalem side, and people's minds are blowing. And then Jesus preaches a message. It's on page 34, and he says this, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will not hunger, and whoever believes in me shall never thirst. Friends, listen, he can do all kinds of cool things that you can see. He can help us get in this building. He could multiply fish. He could heal your body. He can do all these cool things. But the greatest thing he does is right in here when he changes your heart and he quenches your thirst. And friends, he takes the chaos of your life. I promise you, he will put peace there. He takes your mourning and he puts joy there. He will fix and he will change the heart of a human. Jesus can do the seen and Jesus can do the unseen. Can I hear an amen today? So I have these blocks here, these Legos. I have a love-hate relationship with Legos. Anyone that's a parent that has Legos in your house, you know what I'm talking about, right? And you can't throw them away now because this Lego is like 10 bucks. You know, you're like, I'm going to throw it away. I stepped on it. I'm throwing it away. No, that's $10. I'm keeping that, right? So I've got six Legos here. They are 2 by 8, so they have 16 studs on each one of these Legos. Now, if I take these Legos and I show them to you and ask you this question, how many different ways can you put these Legos together? How many different ways can they be situated with each other? How many combinations can you come up with for these six Legos? When I look at this, I would say maybe 100 different ways I could form these Legos, different combinations. Maybe if I'm really, really generous, maybe 1,000 different ways that I could change these different combinations with these six Legos that are 8x2. Maybe there's 1,000 different ways. Well, they ran this equation through a software, and this is the number of different equations, different combinations you could come up with for these six Legos that have 16 studs. You could come up with 915,103,765 different combinations for these six Legos. When I look at that, I don't understand it. Do you understand it? I could work with that the rest of my life, and I couldn't count that many. I do not understand how that could happen. It's the same way when we look at God. We look at God and we say, here's my problem, and I see one way you can fix it. And God says, no, 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 no. I am the creator. I create things out of nothing. I am the one that can make things that you couldn't imagine. As a matter of fact, do you know what he tells you? He says, I can do immeasurably more than what you could even ask or what you could even imagine. And you look at it like I look at this and I say, this way, this way, this way. It could be done this way. 1,000 different ways. And he says, no, there's 1,000,000,000 ways that I can work in your situation. The question is, will you believe? Do you hear me today? The question is, will you believe? How big do you believe your God is? That's the question. Is your God like 100 combinations big? One combination big? That's where we often put him. Hey, I need you to do this to fix my situation. And he says, no, 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 no. I've got 1,000,000,000 ways that will blow your mind. They'll blow your mind. Because God is bigger than what you could ever imagine. That's my one goal today, if you don't remember anything else, for you to get it in your mind that no matter what you're facing, your God is bigger. Come on, your God is bigger. Will you believe? Come on, will you stand with me? Will you believe? Will you have faith? Will you believe? Will you have faith? It's the only position. Remember back to the positions. There's not 20 things you got to get down just right. It's one thing. Do you believe? Do you believe he's bigger than the problem that you face? Come on, he wants to blow your mind today. There's all types of miracles. There's all kinds of things you guys are bringing. Some of you, it's your marriage right now. Like, I only see one way out. Divorce. He sees 1,000,000,000 ways. Someone here today, it's your kid, and you're like, there's only one way I see with this kid. He's got ways you never even imagine. He's able to do exceedingly abundantly above all you could ask and think. His ways are higher than our ways. His thoughts are greater than your thoughts. Come on, if you would close your eyes right now, because it's you and God, I want you to picture your problem, right? What is the impossibility you bring into this place? Come on, your God is bigger than that. Come on, put your eyes on him today. He's bigger than that. He's bigger than that. He's bigger than your problem. Take your eyes off the size of your problem and put your eyes on the size of your God. Come on, do that right now. We put our eyes on you, God. We put our eyes on you, God. Yes, Lord, we put our eyes on you, God. Just do that right now. Come on. It's a mental exercise. Come on, because you got to get your eyes off what's happening. Get your eyes on the size of your God. Yes, God. Yes, God. Yes, God. He's big enough. He's big enough. He's big enough. Come on, we're going to go into a time of worship here, and I'm also going to open the altars. If you need a miracle today, you want us to partner with you in prayer, we invite you to come forward. But everyone here today, no matter what you're facing, I want you to put your eyes on God right now. Come on, but if you need to step out, we'll anoint you with oil and we'll pray with you today.
You will keep your covenant.
Come on, put your eyes on him.
I'm calling on the God of oceans. I need you now to do.
Your faith grow right now.
You
believe it together. Yes, the Word of God says it, so I believe it. I might not understand it, but the Word of God says it, so I believe it. Your life, let him touch your marriage as you put your eyes on him. Come on, we put our eyes on you, Jesus.
Position you for what God wants to do in you and through you. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, let's give him praise for his word today. Amen. Amen. If you're new with us today, we'd love to get your information. You can scan that. We'll be in contact with you this week. But more importantly than that, we are going to give our missionaries a dollar offering on the way out. It's right here, and they're going to be there too. I'm sure they'd love to connect with you. God bless you. The worship is going to continue. If you want to linger in the presence of the Lord, if you want more prayer, you can come forward. God bless you. Thank you for being here.